Hello and welcome to Rathod Science Academy. Today in this session we are going to see current affairs of 12th December 2024. So actually there are very less number of articles which are relevant from our examination point of view. Actually most of articles which are there in our newspaper we covered in our earlier classes. So don't miss our analysis. So try to watch this analysis on everyday basis so that you will be intact with what is happening around us. Okay, now let us see the first article. So see the title, guys. Drive against manual scavenging will continue. So what is the keyword here? Manual scavenging. So what is the meaning of manual scavenging? Manual means by hand. So scavenging means removing something. So what exactly the meaning of manual scavenging? So manual scavenging is nothing but removal of human excreta through hand. Okay, so from which subject you will be seeing this topic? From GS paper 2 under polity. Next, GS paper 1 and 2 society and social issues. Next. Okay, governance, GS paper 2 next. Can we add from ethics? Yes, okay. Next. Can we add science and technology here? Okay, so what can you see from this polity point of view exactly? So can we connect this topic from fundamental rights? And as well as? And apart from this fundamental rights, in where we can see this? Okay, laws. Can I talk about SC, ST, Atrocities Act, that is Civil Liberty Act? Okay, from society point of view, what are the dimensions you have to see? Can I add this under caste-based discrimination in our society? Okay, caste-based discrimination. Next. How it is going to impact? And from governance point of view, you have to see about? What are the recent developments taken by the government to stop this manual scavenging? And from ethics point of view, you can get a case study. And from science and technology, you have to see like how we can use technology for replacing of humans to do this work. Okay, so now let me know some important details from you, like why this manual scavenging is bad. Tell me, what is the negative impact of this manual scavenging? Okay, health issues next. Okay, societal value, okay. Next. What about salary for them? It will be high. Okay, they are low wage salaries next. Is the work continuous? Okay, next. Yes, so because of this still discrimination based on caste is continuing in our society. Next. Yes, it will also have impact on division of labor. Next. Okay, caste-based occupation that comes under themselves. So now tell me, what are the measures can be taken? Measures. So we have to replace machines. Next, can you tell me any such kind of technology developed so far in India? What is that name? Don't know. Okay, tell me, like government is taking any other measures? So how government is giving this protection?
I mean, if you give complaint, then they will
take the... Okay, apart from this, is there any website? Is there any portal? Is there any scheme? I said about this 2 months ago. 2 months ago. Tell me, what are the recent steps taken by government to control this manual scavenging in India? So can you tell me data of deaths in India based on this manual scavenging every year? And at least tell me in which states we have more amount of deaths. More amount of deaths in India in which state? No. Okay, so do this work. See about data of manual scavenging in India, and you have to see what are the measures taken by the government, and you have to see what is the technology in India and as well as in other countries to handle this manual scavenging, and you have to see which are the fundamental rights or conscious provisions are related to this manual scavenging, and what are the laws or acts came up by the government. So more than this, you will be not getting any question out of this in your mains or prelims. You have to see the data so that you can write in your introduction. In the way forward, you can write the measures, and you can give validation by giving, like, in England they are using this kind of technology, or in London they are using this kind of technology, US, Japan, like that. You can give validation, and fundamental rights part you can use if there is any case study in ethics, and laws and acts also will be helpful for your ethics point of view. And if possible, if there is any Supreme Court judgment regarding this manual scavenging, you can also make a note of this and try to do this work and write in an A4 size sheet by today night itself, so that it will be very helpful, guys. So if you're making notes in this way, if any question comes in your examination, you can handle any type of question. Okay, now let us see this article. Now actually Supreme Court is intervening, and Supreme Court came up with a commitment of ending of manual scavenging in India. So that is the thing which mainly said. So if you see what is a manual scavenging, it is a practice of removing of human excreta by hand from either sewers or from septic tanks. So it is not a new phenomenon in our country. So from history onwards, it has been done. So because of this, do you know this Chaturvarna system? What is this Chaturvarna system? So we have Chaturvarna system. In this we have Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. So in these people, do they do this manual scavenging? In this Chaturvarna system, any people who will do this? No, right? So only this Sudras, not Sudras, only this scheduled caste people who are not part of the Chaturvarna system, they will be doing this manual scavenging. That means from history onwards. So when this Chaturvarna system came into existence in India, during which period? During ancient period. That is exactly during Vedic period. During Vedic period, this Chaturvarna system came into existence. So from that period onwards, we are seeing this caste-based discrimination. Okay, so you have to see, like, when this had been started, and you have to see even after independence also, government is focusing on removal of this manual scavenging, and government is ensuring the rights of people under this fundamental rights, and we have Article 14, Article 15, 16, 17, every article is talking about there should be equality. But despite of this, and despite of many laws came by the government, still it is continuing. That means we are having a very deep-rooted stigma, social stigma in our society. So here, if you want to change the mindset of people, then you have to go for attitude. So from ethics point of view, you can get a case study from attitude. Okay. So here, what are the constitutions talks about this manual scavenging? Article 14. What is Article 14? Right to equality, equality before law, and equal protection of law. And Article 15, there should be no discrimination based on caste, religion. And again, based on this caste, there is discrimination which is happening. And next one is Article 16. What is it is saying? There should be no discrimination based on caste, religion in employment. And next one here is 17, talks about untouchability. So who are these people who is doing this manual scavenging? That is SC people. That means there is a untouchability which is going on. And even Article 19(1) subclass G talks about right to practice any profession or to carry any occupation, trade or business. It is getting affected because of this deep-rooted social stigma. So people will say that SC people do have to do that work, not other caste people. That means this Article 19(1) subclass G of this SC people is getting violated. And this one is Article 21 talks about right to life and personal liberty. So because of this manual scavenging, again that article is getting disrupted. And even apart from that, not only articles in our fundamental rights, but even articles out of fundamental rights, like Article 46 and Article 338 also been violated. So what is the impact of this manual scavenging? As you said, there will be increasing of number of deaths because it is dirty work. So according to Union Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, it said that 282 manual scavengers have been lost their life between 2016 to 19, but you have to see this year economic survey data. And student, here is the life of the sanitation workers is very, very difficult because they have to face a lot of racism and social discrimination. And next one is even poverty. Sanitation worker, so they will be getting very less amount of wages, and even they don't get work throughout 365 days. So this is also one problem for them. And even there will be a lot of health issues because they will be working in a very, very contaminous region where they will be having most amount of microorganisms, bacteria, everything. And there is a high chance of getting infections. So that here the average life expectancy of this people is 50. Normal life expectancy is around 66 to 67 years in India. But life expectancy in these people who are working in the sanitation is just 50 years. Okay, see this article. Indian scientists develop novel gene therapy for hemophilia. So what is the keyword here? Gene therapy. And next one is hemophilia. What is this gene therapy? So what is the gene where it is present? Inside DNA, inside a cell. Okay, so what is the meaning of gene therapy then? Therapy is nothing but treatment. So what is okay, we are cutting the genes and we are replacing the required genes, that is called as gene therapy. Okay, so in which subject you will be dealing with that? Science and technology under which chapter? Biotechnology. Okay, so what is this hemophilia then? Hemo is something is about blood. Philia means? Hemophilia. Do you know this Elizabeth? Elizabeth is also having the same disease, hemophilia. So what happened here is, tell me about different types of blood cells. White blood cells, red blood cells, and platelets. Okay, so what is the function of RBC? Red blood cells? Oxygen supply. What is the function of WBC? Defense mechanism. And what is the function of platelets? Platelets, thrombocytes. Blood. It will prevent blood loss. So what happens here is, in this case of hemophilia, there will be lack of function of platelets. Actually, what these platelets do, they will form a mesh so that they will prevent the blood loss. So if you're having some cut, after some time you will be seeing only like white color plasma or white color liquid will be coming out. It will be not blood. Why? Because whenever if there is any cut at that place here, our hormones will be getting activated. It will be activating the platelet works so that platelet will be forming a mesh like this. For example, if you're having a cut like this, so after whenever your platelets get activated, it will be forming just a mesh like this. So in this mesh, this RBC cells will be not able to come outside. So because of this, after some time of getting of wound, you will be getting just white color liquid will be coming at the place of this injury. So what happens here is, so in this hemophilia conditions, this platelets will not be get activated. Continuous blood loss will be happening at the place of wound. So because of this, huge amount of blood loss will happen. Because of this blood loss, the patient will die. Okay, so this is the condition. Actually, it is a genetic condition that can be inherited from your future generations. So here, if you are having any kind of genetic diseases, so we can go for this gene therapy. So whenever we are altering the genes which is responsible for this lack of function of platelets in this disease, we can give the treatment for this hemophilia. That is the thing which we can see here. Okay, so here the keyword here is hemophilia. Hemophilia is related to platelets. So you have to see the function of platelet. Platelet will function to prevent blood loss. So in this hemophilia, what happened? There is irregular function of platelets and it is a genetic disease. So if you're having any wound because of blood loss, loss of life. And now for this hemophilia, we got a biotechnological advancement, and that is now gene therapy. So can you tell me some important keywords that you see in this gene therapy? Like, for example, this is a DNA. So in this DNA, this part is responsible for this hemophilia. Okay, so in this part we have genes, and this genes is responsible for this hemophilia. So we are going to cut this genes and we are going to insert another genes, right? So which is the instrument that we can use to cut this genes? Yes, CRISPR-Cas9. Okay, you have to know this. So we will be using this molecular scissor that is called as CRISPR-Cas9. That will be useful for breaking of this genes, and we will be adding another genes. So what is the gum we are using? So we are replacing this and we are keeping another, right? So how we make that is attach it here. For example, if you want to paste any paper, you will be using gum or Fevicol like that. So here in this case of genes, what is that gum we will be using? In science and technology, sir said about this in biotechnology class. Tell me. What is that gum we can use here to make them attached? I won't give options. No options. Okay, so tell me, what are the advantages of gene therapy? Or applications of gene therapy? Apps, applications. In which areas we can use this gene therapy? In every area. Cancer, okay, next. Okay, so I will be giving you the subheadings. So tell me about agriculture, tell me about economy, tell me about science and environment and ecology, tell me about health sector, tell me about, okay, tell me at least in this sector where we can use, what are the applications of gene therapy in okay, climate resilient seeds, next. Here we can get climate resilient seeds from economy point of view. Because of this gene therapy, can we improve our economic development? Obviously, we can increase our economic development. Next, how economic development or growth of economy will be seen because of this gene therapy? Okay, food security, next. Food security, next. Health of the people will be increased. That means the social capital can be increased. Okay, livelihood can be increased. And we can decrease the burden on the government. Like, government is not, it is not necessary for the government to give more amount of money for the people who are having diseases. Next, for example, government is giving pension or like financial assistance for TB people. How much every year? Sorry, every month, 1,000 rupees. It had been increased recently. Okay, from environment and ecology, how gene therapy can be increased, can be used? Can we ensure biodiversity protection and conservation? Next. Okay, from health point of view, what are the diseases? Especially, you can give treatment for genetic diseases. So can you tell me some examples of genetic diseases that will be inherited from your parents? Kannu. Next. AIDS. AIDS is not genetic. Genetic means nothing but from genes. Genes. Cancer, okay, next. Genetic diseases. It is not genetic. It is lifestyle disease. No. Genetic disease that you will get from your parents. Hair fall. Hair fall. Genetic disease. That's what. That is this hemophilia. Hemophilia, sickle cell anemia. What is a sickle cell anemia? Sickle cell anemia. Next. Have you heard about this Down syndrome, Edwards syndrome, Patau syndrome? Okay, so those are those. So let us see here. Indian scientists have successfully tested a novel gene therapy for severe hemophilia A on 5 patients. Especially by this gene therapy, they eliminated bleeding episodes over 14 month of period. So actually, we find one novel gene therapy for this hemophilia in India. It is one of the great success. So whenever you are talking about recent science and technology advancements in India, so you will be thinking about only space and defense. But even in this biotechnology also, we are running forward. So you can write this kind of example in science and technology developments in India. So from that point of view, this article is very important. Okay. So here, the points that you have to remember is, it is a breakthrough, especially it is one of the innovative approach to treat hemophilia A. And as you all know that India is very good in medical tourism. So if India is doing more research and development in this health field, and whenever we are getting new kind of treatments for the different diseases which are present across the world, which are rarest of rarer diseases. So can you tell me which are those rarer diseases? I gave you a question on this also, I guess. Mains practice question. Tropical neglected diseases. Examples of tropical neglected diseases. They are rarest of rarer diseases. Okay, so if India is developing any therapy or treatment for this tropical and neglected diseases, yes, can we attract more number of people from different countries to India? So that obviously it will be boosting our economy. So the point I wrote here to expect that is, we can increase medical tourism so that it will be contributing our economic growth. Okay. And next one here is, it will be like a safer mode of methodology compared to that of adenovirus based treatments. For example, if you are getting any genetic disease, obviously that is permanently not curable, because it is inherent in each and every cell. Each and every cell is having DNA, and each and every DNA having its own genes which express those things. So here, whatever the medicine that you are taking from outside, it will be not entering into each and every DNA or each and every gene, right? So based on that, if you're taking any symptomatic treatment, for example, if you're having Down syndrome, so there is no permanent cure if you're having genetic diseases, but gene therapy is the one permanent disease for that. So that if you're taking outside medicines, obviously you will be having lots of negative effects, adverse reactions, everything will happen. But gene therapy, it is one of the safe methodology that we can deal with this, the gene genetic diseases. So we can enhance long-term health care outcomes if you're having this gene therapy. And this one is, even we can increase our economy as well. And it is one of the scientific milestones, so that our country's capability will be increasing in this research and innovation in this health field. Okay, so that's it, nothing more than this. And see the applications of gene therapy. So especially for genetic disorders like hemophilia, muscular dystrophy, sickle cell anemia, retinitis pigmentosa. I have this retinitis pigmentosa. So these are some, because of some defective genes that you will be having. So for this, we can go for this genetic therapy. And next one is for cancers also, we can use this gene therapy. And even for some neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's disease. So many a times you have studied about this Alzheimer's disease. What is this Alzheimer's disease? That is memory loss. So normally, especially women will be more vulnerable for this Alzheimer's disease compared to that of male. Why? Because in your brain, the formation of plaques will happen, so that the function of your brain will be reduced, and obviously your memory will be getting decreased. So it is also one genetic disease. Okay, so for all these things, we can use this gene therapy. and see this article: India accounts for half of malaria cases in Southeast Asia in 2023. What is the keyword here? Malaria. And one more thing is Southeast Asia. So tell me location of Southeast Asia, where it is located. Can I say location is also responsible for the different kinds of diseases which are prevalent in that area? Yes or no? So what is happening now? There is increasing of temperature, global warming, climate change is happening. And if you see the Southeast Asia, whether it is present in tropical or temperate region? Tropical region. Okay. So in tropical region, what happens? Temperature will be more or less? More or less temperature, tell me. 0 degrees, 30 degrees north, 60 degrees north, 90 degrees north. 30 degrees south, 60 degrees south, and 90 degrees south. So this region is tropical region, and this region temperate, this region polar. Okay, Southeast Asia is present in this part. That means exactly the tropical region we are having this Southeast Asia. And now let us see the connection here. So there is climate change and increasing of global warming. So how this global warming is related to malaria cases increase? Tell me, is there any connection? Southeast Asia is located in tropical region, and now there is increasing of global warming, and this article is saying that there is increasing of malaria cases. So malaria is caused by what? Mosquito, directly? Directly mosquito will cause this, or any parasite? Or any bacteria or virus? Malaria is caused by which organism? Plasmodium. Is Plasmodium bacteria or virus? Plasmodium falciparum, Plasmodium vivax. There are five variants in this Plasmodium. It is a parasite. It is not a bacteria. It is not a virus. And where is this parasite will present? In the gut of mosquito. In the gut of mosquito, it will present. So because of mosquito bite, this Plasmodium will be entering into humans. So actually what this mosquito will do is, whenever it starts biting, it will be releasing saliva. Why? Because whenever we are having a small injury, as I said, our platelets will be getting activated and it will form a mesh. So whenever mesh is formed, can it suck the blood? No. So to stop this platelets activation, so it will release some enzyme. That enzyme is present in the saliva of mosquito. So whenever mosquito is releasing its saliva, along with that saliva, whatever this Plasmodium parasite which is present in this gut also, it will be released along with this saliva of this mosquito. So because of this, as soon as mosquito bite is happening, even this Plasmodium will be entering into your body. Okay, so tell me, what is the relationship between this global warming and malaria, Plasmodium, mosquito? So I think in one of our Sunday's class I discussed, because of increasing of temperature, it becoming good breeding for this mosquito. This temperature is very suitable for growing of mosquito population. So whenever there is increasing of mosquito population, obviously mosquito related vector diseases are increasing. This is a story. Have you understood? So because of increasing of global warming, increasing of mosquito population, and mosquito borne diseases are increasing in this tropical region, especially in Southeast Asia. Okay, now tell me, in India, for example, if the cases are increasing, so what are the steps can be taken by our government of India? For example, if you are a DM in your district, you got a report that huge number of malaria cases, you got report from your higher authorities about your inaction. What are the options that are available to you? What are the measures you will be taking, or what is your course of action? Okay, you have to focus on sanitation. Apart from that, who will kill more mosquitoes? They will get money. How? How is it possible? They will kill mosquitoes and they will bring to you to count them. Will you count that? How many mosquitoes they kill? Oh, local employment creation. Next. Old bitch, okay, old bachia technique, very good. So what is this old bachia technique? It is a gene therapy for mosquitoes. Next. Next. Sterilization, that comes under that only, sterilization of mosquitoes. Stopping the production of mosquito is old bachia technique. Next. So where this mosquito breeding will happen, whenever there is stagnation of water, so you have to go for prevention of stagnation of water. And next one is, do you know there are some special species of fishes that will be feeding on only larvae of mosquito? What is that fish? Gambusia. So you have to leave this Gambusia fishes in the places where we have stagnant water. Next. So we can also add a little drop of oil or kerosene on this stagnant water so that it will be forming a layer. It will be not allow oxygen to enter into this water so that that larvae will be dying, obviously. And next, fishes also, if we are not having any fishes in that region. And next, fishes without water. And next, mosquito nets, providing of mosquito nets. Next, okay, mosquito repellents. Okay, so what are the things that you have? Okay, see. So just see about some facts of malaria. So how it is causing everything. And especially you have to focus on what is the India vision. So this is very important. So already what are the steps taken by our government is Ministry of Health and Family Welfare launched a national framework for malaria elimination 2016 itself. And we also have a good vision of malaria free country by 2027 and elimination by 2030. I don't know whether it is possible or not. We are already in 2025 almost. So 2025 is malaria free country. Is that possible according to you? Just 2 years more. Yes. Okay, I'm talking about 2027. I'm not talking about 2030. Okay, think that is up to you. And see this article. Vicom, two states, two leaders and a tale of reform. So what is this Vicom Satyagraha? This is very, very important topic because this year is marking 100 years of Vicom Satyagraha. So from history point of view, how can you expect the question is, if it is 25 years anniversary or if it is 50 years anniversary, 75 years, 100 years, 125 and 150, you will be getting for sure question. So in 2025, if you are writing prelims, so you have to go back to 1925 and as well as 1825 like that, what are the events that happened in that year? You have to focus for sure. For sure, there will be one question every year. So this year, this is the most important topic, Vicom. So Vicom Satyagraha is nothing but temple entry movement. So why there was a temple entry movement during that time? Okay, there was a caste discrimination. So which people are not allowed to enter into temples? Dalits. So at that time, they started Vicom Satyagraha. So, and this is considered as one of the first temple entry movement in our history. Okay, see some facts regarding this Vicom, it is enough. So Vicom Satyagraha, it is a non-violent agitation. So you will be getting questions like, consider the following statements regarding Vicom Satyagraha. It was started by so-and-so person and they may give, it is a violent agitation. No, it is non-violent agitation and it is considered as first temple entry movement in India. So like that, they will give some statements and they will be asking you which of the following are correct or incorrect statements. And you have to be very careful while dealing with that kind of statements. So Vicom Satyagraha, it is a non-violent agitation in Vicom within the princely states of Travancore, Kerala. Especially it was started from 30th March 2024 till 23rd November 1925. That means this year and next year will be marking exactly 100 years of this Vicom Satyagraha. And this movement, it was against practices of untouchability and caste discrimination. And even whenever you are writing about any answer regarding caste discrimination or like untouchability, you can add even this kind of temple entry movements that started in modern history because of this caste discrimination during that modern period. And next one is, this movement was triggered by prohibition of people from oppressed classes, especially Aizawals, from walking on the road surrounding the Vicom Mahadev temple. And next one is, this is the first among the temple entry movements in India. and who are the key figures. So from these key figures also there is a chance of getting question like which of the following personalities involved in this movement. So the first one is T.K. Madhavan, second one is K.P. Keshava Menon, and next one is K. Kalappan. So these are the three famous personalities in this Vaikom Satyagraha. Okay, that's it. And even this movement gained more power when Mahatma Gandhi reached Vaikom in March 1925. So after this Vaikom Satyagraha, so at the time of 1936, so Maharaja of Travancore signed a historic temple entry proclamation. And in that proclamation, they removed age-old ban of entry of marginalized caste into the temple of Travancore. So after the Satyagraha, now the temple doors were open even for this marginalized sections. And Vaikom Satyagraha also led to the division in perspectives, with a few viewing that Hindu reformist movement, while others say that it is fight against caste-based atrocities. Some will be thinking that this is against like caste, some will be thinking like it is Hindu reformist movements. That's it. And there is one article regarding ONOS. What is ONOS? One Nation, One Subscription. Already we have discussion on that. So just see this. So because of this One Nation, One Subscription, if you are taking one subscription, you will be having access to the different research papers, journals. There is no need of taking separate subscriptions for the different universities. Okay, so because of this, it will be improving research and development in our country. Especially it is helpful economically for the PhD students who are working on this research. Okay, so these are the important topics that appeared in our today's Hindu newspaper. By this, I'm concluding. Thank you so much for watching. And we are providing free quiz. So try to attend that in our app. And also try to share this class to your friends. And do subscribe to Rathod's IAS Academy.